This is the show where NFL legends come to tell their stories. This is the show where we spotlight what's good in the world of sports. This is also the show where we appreciate the NFL Alumni Association and the Gridiron Greats. For this is Thursday Night Tailgate with your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. Guys, it's finally tonight. I've waited all day. Have a good time and take it away.
For tonight either. Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Joe. Thanks to all of you for coming back and joining us tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate, where your favorite NFL legends live on. Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari back with you on a beautiful rainy night here in Atlanta. And just like the NFL, well, you know what we do? We play through the rain. Make it a little sloppy, but you know what? That's football. That's how it goes. Tonight, we're going to talk more football. We got some great guests. We'll talk a little baseball. Plus, you know, our spotlight on the positive segment where we'll highlight a couple of more great stories for you about guys doing some great things out there in their communities. And you know what? We're going to have a lot of fun doing it. We'll do it over the next couple of hours. Bob, how are you tonight, my friend?
Hey, Chris. I'm doing okay. How about yourself?
I'm good, thank you. I'm a little nervous. I'm going to have a couple of wisdom teeth pulled in the morning. So as you can imagine, not looking forward to that, anticipating a sort of long, uncomfortable weekend coming up. I wish it was during the regular football season. At least I'd have that to look forward to, a little college football, a little NFL football, Saturday, Sunday, kind of spend my weekend. But tune in, little Red Sox. I'll be spending a lot of time in front of the tube laying down, relaxing. But hopefully it all goes well in the morning. I haven't had teeth pulled since I was a kid, so not looking forward to that at all.
Well, it gives you an excuse, Chris. Just, you know, chill out, lay back, have the wife bring you some drinks. You know, that's all. Your time, man. Your time. Enjoy.
Good point. I like it. Glass half full. I appreciate that, Bob. I intend to do exactly that, my friend. All right, so tonight we got another great lineup in store for you, and it's going to start out with our good friend and TNT Hall of Famer, AT&T Sportsnet Pittsburgh host, Paul Alexander. And Bob, you know, it's always great, first of all, having Paul on the show. He's a great friend of ours. He's been very kind and generous to us over the years, so look forward to catching up with him. And you know, I got to find out what's going on with the Steelers so far in training camp, get Paul's insights there. Plus, we'll go back. We'll talk some of those 1970s Pirates teams since we've got Al Oliver. Oh, by the way, spoiler alert, joining us a little bit later on the show as well. But looking forward to both of those things with Paul, Bob.
Yeah, he's anytime we have one of our own Hall of Famers, Chris, we feel honored and excited because these guys keep coming back and they continue to be terrific guests. And Paul is the dean of Pittsburgh sports, so can't wait to speak with him.
Absolutely. He'll be back with us about 15 minutes from now. At the bottom of the hour, just like every week, Tony Collins will join us. We'll talk more about what's going on with the Patriots and training camp and get more of Tony's stories about a half an hour from now. 45 minutes from now, we're going to be joined by former Pitt and Cincinnati Bengals linebacker Ricardo McDonald. And Bob, Ricardo is the twin brother of former Colts linebacker Devon McDonald, who has joined us here on the show a few times, lining him up for next week as well. And one of the things is I was doing the research on Ricardo, looking at his Wikipedia page. It says he suffered at least 20 concussions, one where his doctor said his brain was 60% swollen. Then he went out and played that week and suffered another concussion on top of that. Unbelievable story. I'm really curious to hear how that happened and then what the side effects of that have been, Bob.
Yeah, it was a different game and a different society back in the 90s, Chris, when this was all going on. But we just hope he's okay. We'll talk more of him. And might be the first brother combination we've had on the show, twin brothers of our good friend Devon. So great to have him.
Yeah, absolutely it is. And look forward to catching up with him, like I say, about 45 minutes from now. We'll kick off hour number two with a return visit, as I mentioned a moment ago, of former Pirates, Rangers, and Expos outfielder, first baseman, and seven-time All-Star, Al Oliver. And Bob, you know, Al has joined us several times, both here on TNT and then over on the television side as well. One of our all-time favorite guests here on the show, and a great member of those 1970s Pirates teams. But I want to get to Al's memories. We recently lost an integral part of those team's starting rotations. Bruce Keeson passed away not long ago. I want to get Al's memories of Bruce, and then really want to talk also about, you know, why he retired when he retired. Because if you look back over his stats, Bob, and I'm sure you have, he was still a very productive player. I mean, he played 18 years in the majors. In those last couple of years, he was still a productive hitter. And think of a guy like Al, who was less than 300 hits short of 3,000. And you think, like I say, when you look at his stats, he had over 300, his second to last year in the league. I'm sure an American League team could have used him at DH. Want to find out what was behind that, why he decided to walk away at that point. But anyway, looking forward to Al about an hour from now, Bob.
Yeah, he's one of our favorites, Chris. Every time I post his interview that we did on the TV side, I always get some great feedback. People say the same thing. My God, that guy can hit line drives. And everybody we talk to says the same thing. 18-year career. Love talking to him.
After Al, we'll round out tonight's show with a return visit from former University of Georgia and Denver Broncos running back Olandis Gary. And Bob, with the University of Georgia right on the cusp for that last year of a national championship, right, losing in the title game to Alabama, want to get Olandis' thoughts on whether he thinks, A, Georgia can get right back into that title game. The expectation is that high. And if anything short of that is going to be a disappointment to him and to UGA fans. And, of course, also get some thoughts on the Broncos as well.
Yeah, see how the Broncos are going to fare according to him. And, again, a guy that had such an incredible rookie year in 99 with the Broncos. And, again, he's joined us a few times, Chris. It's always a lot of fun with him.
So there you go. We're going to have a lot of fun tonight here on TNT. So you know what, folks? Sit back, relax. Let us take your mind off everything else going on in your life for the next couple of hours. And, folks, as you know, we are brought to you tonight by the great folks over at the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory, the Salt Creek Golf Retreat up in beautiful Nashville, Indiana, our partners at the NFL Alumni Association, Mike Ditka's great organization, the Gridiron Greats, who we love. Go online and check them out at gridirongreats.org. Also, check out former Houston Oilers quarterback Dan Pastorini and his company, DP Quality Foods. Dan has a lineup of award-winning spices that you're going to love. Go online to dpqualityfoods.com to check them out for yourself. And former Pro Bowl quarterback Drew Bledsoe and his company, Doubleback Winery. You can find their great selection of wines online at doubleback.com.
It's time for another edition of Bob's Take. So, Bob, tell us, what's on your mind tonight?
Yeah, let's get into this week's edition of Bob's Take. And, Bob, I want to start tonight by getting your take on Terrell Owens and the Hall of Fame. We know he held his own event there at his alma mater, the University of Tennessee at Chattanooga. And during his, you know, quote-unquote induction speech, he blamed the media for why he chose not to be up in Canton, saying that media members and particularly those who vote on the Hall of Fame inductees disregarded the process for how the selection is supposed to be done. He said he's taken a stand for those who come after him so they don't have to go through what he did and what he meant by that being passed over for 3 years before getting in. And, Bob, here's what I'll say in his defense. I think this is even a bigger issue in Major League Baseball. You know, if a player earns the right to be in the Hall, they should be in regardless of what, you know, media members or what the voters perceive of him. And I get that T.O. wasn't well-liked, you know, in some of the teams that he played on, particularly with those Eagles teams and even when he started out towards the end of his time there in San Francisco. So I'm sure that, you know, that perception of T.O., the things that we saw of him negatively impacted the voters' willingness to vote him in right away, be a first ballot Hall of Famer, sort of give him that tag. But, Bob, for players like T.O., who are at or near the top of every category in their position, in this case, T.O. with receiving categories, is he right to call out the voters for delaying his induction for something other than his performance on the field? Or should that be a part of the selection piece, not giving the guy that sort of that high level of first ballot Hall of Famer because of the way that they acted?
Well, let's get it straight, Chris. I think I agree exactly what you said before. There is no way he should not have been inducted right off the bat, if not that, in the second year. So that, in that case, Chris, there's no question that the committee was throwing their ego around, and that should never be the case. But it's almost like the Hall of Fame committee was, they wanted to send a message to him that we call the shots, you don't. And it should never get to that point, Chris, but that's what happened during those first 2 years. Now, if Owens is anybody but Terrell Owens, he would probably go through his business, Chris. There's no question, and the numbers are there. He's going to get in. If it's not this year, it's the next year. It's not that year. It was so silly. But he has to, he's one of these guys. You've asked most of his teammates. He's a me type of guy who always likes the attention on him. So, in fact, I had one writer writing today said he thinks secretly that Owens might not be happy that it got in, so he couldn't play the sulking bad guy anymore. You know, so he's got that kind of reputation, Chris. It was bad on both counts. I mean, let's put it this way: he could have come out and tell you what the problem was and give his grief and everything and through the press and do that and still show up in Canton. I do not think his fellow inductees were too happy about it. Even Michael Irvin went out and kind of called him on it and said, look, you know, is it his prerogative? Yeah, it is, but you don't go along that way. But that's Terrell being Terrell, Chris. That's it is what it is. But again, deserving, yes. Should he have been there? Yes, also.
Next, Bob, I want to get your thoughts on Dez Bryant and his continued free agency. It seems like teams are staying away and may only consider bringing him in. At least it feels like they're looking at it. Hey, look, if we get an injured wide receiver, maybe we take a look at a Dez Bryant. Certainly teams have not been falling all over themselves, obviously, to go sign him because he's still out there. But, you know, could this be the end for Dez Bryant? I mean, if no one gets injured at this point, and we know that it happens, so in all likelihood, he probably lands somewhere else. But it seems like there is that possibility, since the phone isn't ringing, if a guy doesn't go down, particularly at number one doesn't go down, he may not get signed again. I don't know. What's your take?
His problem, Chris, is that he wanted to come back on his own terms, totally on his own terms, and have it be a perfect situation for him. As you remember, if I'm not mistaken, the Bengals had a good contract for him in place, a couple years, I believe, a lot of money on the table, and he just said no. He said, I want to go to a contending team. Now, how he thought he would step in and start for one of the quote-unquote contending teams out there when he's probably lost a step or two, I don't know, Chris, but it kind of backfired on him. And I think you're right. I mean, if there's an injury, yeah, his phone might ring, but it might not be from one of those teams he thought. And he's probably going to be rusty. He's going to come in late. It's a mess, and it's all in his hands. But, again, maybe if your last name is Bryant and you're a wide receiver, Chris, this crazy things happen to you in the NFL. But he's one of these guys, again, a guy that you'd have to think twice, too, about signing him because he's one of those guys. If he's not getting the ball, Chris, and I'm talking even on a great team, he might not be the best presence in the locker room. We hope that's not the case, but he's proved it over and over. He wants the ball, and he will let you know, and he'll throw sideline tantrums. If you're a good team and you want that on your sideline, well, you better have room for it to kind of breathe. But, again, a guy that kind of dug his own grave.
And to the point that you just made a moment ago, right, about if your last name is Bryant. That's the other one I want to get your thoughts on, is Martavis Bryant, right? He seems to be finding his way into John Gruden's doghouse. Hasn't learned the playbook well enough yet. Gruden has called him out publicly through the media about that. So when you look at a talented guy like Martavis Bryant, again, as a Steeler fan, I saw it, you know, week in and week out when he was there, that he has all the tools. He's tall, he's fast, he's got pretty decent hands. But is this a guy who might be letting his career slip away from him because of all the off-the-field stuff and obviously how he's presented himself to Gruden and the Raiders?
This is a crossroads time for him, Chris. He's 26 years old, just hitting his prime. Like you said, has the natural gifts, size, can run. You saw him in Pittsburgh. It must make you shake your head. But, John, the good news, I guess, for Raider fans is Coach Gruden today kind of softened his stance on it. They called it, the NFL.com called it the good cop routine from Gruden today. He said he's not a good talent. He's a great talent. And today I think he showed us what he's capable of doing. So, you know, Gruden's one of these guys that gets in your head, Chris. You know, he might have tweaked him earlier in the week, and just to get to light a fire under him, you know, Gruden can coach. He's an old-time, old-school coach. Don't know if that's going to work these days. But for a guy like him, it might work because he did respond already. And if he does pick up the playbook, Chris, you know the natural ability he has, and Carr to get him the ball won't be a problem. But today, I guess it's better news, but you're right. If he takes any negative steps back, we may be talking about him years down the road of the Martavis Bryant, what might have been.
There you go, folks. That is this week's edition of Bob's Take. And as you guys know, we are sponsored by the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. And if you love baseball, folks, you've got to go check out the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. They were inducted into the TripAdvisor Certificate of Excellence Hall of Fame. In the museum, it's a wonderful experience for everybody in your family because you get to walk their live production line and see some of the 1.8 million bats that they make every year, and they've been doing it now for 134 years. Don't miss the bat vault when you go in there because you can hold game-used bats from guys, some of the greatest players in the history of Major League Baseball. Guys like Hank Aaron, Ted Williams, my hero growing up, Willie Stargell. To find out more information about the museum and to book your visit, go online to sluggermuseum.com. We're also proud to be sponsored by our good friend and TNT Hall of Famer Randy Minear and the great folks at the Salt Creek Golf Retreat up in beautiful Nashville, Indiana, which, oh, by the way, was voted one of the top 20 small towns in the country by Smithsonian Magazine, as well as one of our newer sponsors, former Houston Oilers quarterback Dan Pastorini and DP Quality Foods. Let's hear about both of them from our announcer, Joe LaGenusa.
If you're looking for a great place for your annual golf outing, a weekend golf getaway, or just a round of golf with your buddies, then Salt Creek Golf Retreat is just what you're looking for. Centrally located in Nashville, Indiana, just south of Indianapolis and west of Cincinnati, this challenging but fair 18-hole golf course appeals to all skill levels, and its scenic views of rolling hills and tree-lined fairways are sure to make golfing memories for years to come. Owned and operated by former Purdue and New York Giants fullback Randy Minear, Salt Creek Golf Retreat offers stay-and-play packages that include golf and a fully furnished one- or two-bedroom condo. After your round, be sure to stop by the 19th hole sports bar and restaurant for great food, fun, and drinks. Randy and his staff will treat you like family. For more information, log on to saltcreekgolf.com. That's saltcreekgolf.com. Or give them a call at 812-558-5944. Salt Creek Golf Retreat. Start making your golfing memories today. Most folks are familiar with Dan Pastorini's accomplishments on the football field or in race cars. But what most don't know? Dan's family background in the restaurant business. For 37 years, Dan's parents, Dante and Dorothy, owned and operated Pastorini's Longhorn Restaurant. So the Pastorini family has a long history of making great-tasting food from family recipes. Dan and his partners want to bring some of that to you with their Texas-style rub, Texas-style hickory rub, and their garlic and herb seasoning. First introduced back in 2011, Dan's Texas-style rub immediately began winning awards, taking home the first place trophy for best ribs at the Pasadena Livestock Show and Barbecue Cook-Off. They did it again at the 2012 Texas Ranger Wounded Warrior Cook-Off, and the awards just keep on coming. Check out Dan's line of spices online at dpqualityfoods.com. That's dpqualityfoods.com. And take what you put on the grill to a whole new level.
Yeah, check them both out online at saltcreekgolf.com and dpqualityfoods.com. All right, now back with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is AT&T Sports Net host and TNT Hall of Famer Paul Alexander. Pittsburgh sports fans can hear and see Paul hosting pre- and post-game shows for the Pirates and the Penguins on AT&T Sports Net Pittsburgh. He also covers the Steelers. He's been a fantastic contributor to us here on the show and a guy we always look forward to and enjoy spending time with. And we are honored he is back again with us tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Paul, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming back on the show.
Gentlemen, my pleasure. How have you been?
Oh, we're fantastic. How are things going for you, my friend?
I can't complain. It's just silly to do so, and I have nothing to complain about. So it would be an exercise in futility.
Good for you. So, Paul, I want to start out our time with you tonight by getting your thoughts on what you're hearing and what you're seeing from Steelers training camp so far. How do you feel? Is this a team we should all be getting excited about?
I don't think there's any question. The only thing that could prevent this team from being, aside from Jacksonville, a legitimate contender for another trip, maybe to a Super Bowl, would be the drama. There's just so many, you know, the Le'Veon Bell, you know, Antonio Brown, is as hard as he works and as great as he is, there's just always something a little off with him, with the disappearing, you know, not showing up for practice. And talent-wise, if they shore up a linebacker that will replace, you know, Ryan Shazier with some sort of, not necessarily that the spectacular play that he presented, but just something solid in there and that, you know, that inside spot. I really believe this is, you know, one of the class acts in the AFC. I don't think there's any question. I really think that New England is not going to be a factor this year. I think that's finally starting to disintegrate a little bit. Without, you know, a salary cap situation, it's not that limited in terms of how you keep things together. You know, New England's not going to be who they've been. So I really believe that the AFC's wide open. And I believe right now, and again, we're very early. We're talking about most rosters around 90. We have to pare down to 53. So while I'm actually watching the Steelers play right now, leading Philadelphia, I think, 15-7 or 8 or whatever, strange score. We have a ways to go before we know. I like to see the final 53 before I get a real sense of who each team is. But they are a legitimate contender in the AFC, no doubt.
So a couple of things based on what you just said, Paul. First of all, obviously the thing that sticks out is Patriots not a factor this season. Why do you think they're not going to be a factor?
I just think now that the rift, I think there's a legitimate rift between Brady and Belichick. You know, the Garoppolo thing is real. That involved ownership, that involved Kraft. You know, Chuck Nolan, and I know, Chris, you're a big fan of the old Steeler guys. And Chuck Nolan would say, if you're contemplating retirement, just retire. And now, you know, the fact that Gronk has, you know, talked about how limited his years are now, and he's really thinking about his future. You know, that's a lot of guys starting to check out. I think Belichick, and one thing I will say to the Steelers fans in particular that aren't a big fan of Belichick, all Belichick is Chuck Knoll in this modern era. Chuck Knoll created a culture. Chuck Knoll was in charge. Chuck Knoll was a dictator. Chuck Knoll didn't take anything from anybody, and that's exactly who Bill Belichick is, and I think that's still the one difference between the Steelers and the Patriots is the culture. And I really believe it's just starting to disintegrate a little bit. When Brady was all on board with the way Belichick did things, then there's really no reason not to put them right up there as a legitimate Super Bowl contender every year. Just those two. They're that impressive. But I think there's a rift there now. That's why I'll say I think the Patriots are done.
And something you alluded to a moment ago, culture with the Steelers, and that's always been a big thing, right, throughout, you know, since the 70s. And the thing with the Rooney family and all that is just fantastic stuff. We always hear people sing the praises of that. Now, where question has been raised, and James Harrison did it, right, a couple of weeks ago, talking about Tomlin.
He sure did.
The difference between the Patriots and the Steelers is the way that Belichick runs his team, which is what you just talked about a moment ago, in stark contrast to the way Tomlin has been handling the Steelers. Do you think there's any validity in what Harrison's been saying?
Well, I mean, he lived it. I mean, James Harrison made the greatest defensive play in Super Bowl history against the Cardinals. Should have been probably the Super Bowl MVP, although the catch that Antonio Holmes made, I think, you know, it's always what happens toward the end that it seems to solidify those kind of honors. But, yeah, James Harrison, and again, to kind of straighten that out, both parties did not conduct themselves in a great way. James Harrison did not want to be an insurance policy for the Steelers last year. And when they didn't play him and he didn't get a hat on game day, that's what he became. He was only going to play and only going to get, you know, an opportunity to participate if there was an injury. So the Steelers kind of were disingenuous in how they approached his contract. So I didn't blame him for going to the Patriots. I was relieved that New England did not win the Super Bowl, because that would have been a little too bitter, I think, of a pill to swallow for the Steelers. But I think the points that he made about the differences between Tomlin and Belichick are very real. I love Mike Tomlin. I think he expects his players, who are all adults, to conduct themselves like adults. But keep in mind, the elite athlete is treated differently from probably eighth or ninth grade. The rules don't apply to them. They're special. And if you don't rein that in, and like Bill Belichick does, keep in mind, he took in a Randy Moss. He took in a lot of players that other coaches couldn't handle and reined them in. And if they didn't fly right, they weren't going to be a part of what he did. Unfortunately, right now, the inmates run the asylum at most NFL camps. They're getting paid a lot more than the coach. They're the stars. And coaches get run out. You know, you can't fire the players. So what they do is they fire the coaches. And the coaches know that. So I don't think there's many cultures out there. And I think now, and the reason I'm kind of declaring the Patriots done, I think there's now a rift between Kraft, Belichick, and Brady. So that triumvirate of excellence has now been kind of disrupted. I know the Rooneys are still amazing, but they let Mike Tomlin run the football team. And he and Kevin Colbert do a great job. But the players now, they go to the beat of their own drummer. You know, they show up when they want, they do what they want. And I have a real dear friend now that's, you know, on the Steelers staff, and he's come from the college game, and he just can't believe the culture. That, I mean, think about, we were talking, I'm in an event right now, a real nice charity event, where just talking a little sports and a little football, and it's so different now. When I used to go to Steeler camp in the 80s, early 80s is when I started covering the Steelers, and they did Oklahoma drills, they did two-a-days, full pads. It was honest-to-goodness football every day at camp. I understood why fans would pack St. Vincent College in Latrobe to see that. What they see now are guys in shorts running around, doing walkthroughs, just kind of making sure that no one gets hurt. You wonder why they can't tackle in the NFL right now. They never practice it. Granted, you have a four preseason schedule where they actually do play football, but that's a very short sample to figure out if a guy can play NFL football or not. draft a kid out of college, never seen him play it down in the NFL, and you have to make a very astute and quick evaluation of their potential without actually ever seeing them play a lot of football. It's very difficult. Football's very different now.
Bob, questions for Paul?
Paul, it leads perfectly into the couple questions I wanted to ask you about the modern athlete, and I'm just thinking about this whole Le'Veon Bell situation and if Belichick was coaching him, how that might work out. But as far as him being in Pittsburgh, Paul, I mean, how close did these two sides get to a contract? Is there an incredible amount of disappointment in what's going on? And is it really, we're getting the feeling that this may be it for him in Pittsburgh? They might want to go out with a championship because it might be his last year there?
Yeah, I think that's the sense. The thing that really bothers me about Le'Veon, I love him as a player. I really do. I think he's probably, you know, certainly one of the top two or three backs in the NFL. Him out of the backfield as a receiver is incredible. But he's not worth $6 or $7 million per year above the next highest paid running back in the NFL. He's just not that different. And with a cap situation, you can't pay that position that much money and expect to fill out your roster in a championship form. And the thing that bothers me about Le'Veon, even though he's a great worker, had a little trouble early, had the little weed incident, but I think he's really flown right since then. Every time he speaks, he never talks about a championship. He never talks about his teammates. He never talks about the team. It's all about him. And that's the culture we live in. It's a me, look at me kind of world that we live in. And football still is the ultimate team sport. You know, you figure the three elements, offense, defense, special teams. If one single person, either defensively or offensively, breaks down, so does the whole play. So I really think that Le'Veon Bell, as great as he is as a player, just his overall attitude and approach is not championship caliber. You have to play for one another. You have to sacrifice for the team. And that's how you win championships. And this guy will never do that. I think when he touches the ball, he gives it his all. I think that his offseason workouts are legit. I think he shows up in tremendous shape. But I don't think he really puts the team and winning a championship above himself and his contract. And that, to me, is a real way to kind of sabotage the entire effort. And that's what I think. He is not a popular guy here in Pittsburgh right now. He's just not. I think that, you know, keep in mind, Hines Ward held out at some point. You know, the NFL without guaranteed contracts, if you outperform your contract, you have to hold out to get paid, you know, fair market value. I get that. Just keep in mind, if you have a player that you signed to a long-term deal that all of a sudden isn't the player that he used to be, you cut him. And, you know, the fans would say, he signed a contract. He's obligated to show up. You know what? Jason Gilden is the example I always use. The Steelers cut Jason Gilden. I think he had like $34 or $35 million left on a deal, but he wasn't as good as he was, so they cut him. And no one ever says anything, oh, the Steelers have to pay him that anyhow. No, they never look at it that way. So I get all of that, but at the same time, if there's not a, you know, I love Mike Tomlin's expression, you know, all oars in the water rowing in the same direction. If you don't have that, you're not going to win. You're not going to win a championship. You're not going to win a Super Bowl. It's too hard. It's the culture in which we live. It's social media. It's the negativity that we see on Twitter, the negativity we see in sports talk radio now. It's a different world. The team concept is not really what it used to be.
And Paul, one more. I mean, I want to talk to, since he was a former Steeler, I got to ask you what Chris asked me about Martavis Bryant. And, heard earlier in the week, trouble with the playbook, not performing up to his abilities. Mr. Budin kind of softened his stance on that today, lauding his talents, etc. Is this guy really at a crossroads? And do you think a guy like Budin, an old style coach, can get this guy where he needs to be, Paul?
I don't believe so. What a shame. What a waste of a. I heard you mention earlier, Chris, that, you know, just his size, strength, speed, ability, the way he takes the top off a defense is incredible. But he's another guy that doesn't push himself. He's a guy that you can't count on. He's a guy that you can almost tell when he, you know, breaks the huddle that he's not the primary receiver just by his body language. So John Gruden has his hands full with a guy like Martavis Bryant, because it's like girls that are attracted to the bad boy. You know, they think that even though this guy has a horrible reputation, they're going to be the one that reins him in, and he's going to be a good guy and be cool and figure it out. Every coach feels the same when they see that abundance of talent, that natural ability, that unbelievable God-given skill. They think that their coaching and their ability to get through to somebody is going to change him. Martavis Bryant is not going to change. He's just not. So that's going to be a problem. If he shows up on a given day and feels like he's engaged and wants to participate, he'll be fantastic. Same guy on a different day that's not feeling it, he could be a complete liability.
Paul, one more before we let you go. And you and I both grew up watching those 1970s Pirates teams. And we have the privilege of having that with tonight, Chris.
Chris, I just want to share. I just spent a good hour with Steve last tonight, who threw complete games, including Game 7 in 1971, to beat Baltimore. One of the nicest, classiest men I've ever met. So, yes, I can completely relate to the 70s Pirates who won World Series in 1971 and 1979, yes.
And we have the privilege of having Al Oliver back on a little bit later tonight, and I want to get your memories of Al.
Well, he was the consummate hitter, career 300 hitter, absolutely just so tremendous in center field. He was one of those guys, I mean, there's not many guys left to throw like totally overhand. I mean, imagine a guy that just threw completely over the top. And that was Al Oliver. He didn't have Roberto Clemente's arm because no one else did either. But he had a good arm from center field, and Al Oliver covered that ground very well. And he was just one of the toughest outs in baseball. And as you know, as a human being, there's no better than Al Oliver. None.
Well, Paul, before we let you go, remind our listeners once again, how can they stay up to date with all the great things you're doing, my friend?
Well, check us out on AT&T Sportsnet, Pirates pre- and post-game. The Pirates still have a pulse. They're still alive and well. Well, maybe not well, but they're alive in that wild card race in the National League. I'm on Twitter on PAlexander44, and I think I put too much stuff on Facebook. I should probably back off that.
Well, Paul, it's always a thrill and a privilege for Bob and I to get to spend some time with you. Thank you for your time tonight coming back on the show. We hope you'll do it again soon.
We'll get maybe
a little bit later on in the season.
You guys are the absolute best. God bless both of you. I love the show. I love what you do. Keep it positive. Keep it rolling. And just keep doing what you're doing, guys.
Thank you, Paul.
Thanks a lot, Paul. Take care, my friend. All the best to you and your family. We look forward to catching up soon.
See you guys.
Take it easy.
See you, Paul. That is AT&T Sportsnet up in Pittsburgh host Paul Alexander. And to turn the tables a little on Paul, Bob, they don't come better than him.
You know, I just love the way he responds to Chris, to questions. He'll give you his reasons, and he makes you think twice of what you might have been thinking about. And that's a tremendous journalist. And we get it from him every time he's on, and the time just flies by, doesn't it?
Yes, it really does. It's just like we just get started with him, and then we got to let him go. So hopefully we get him back here again real soon. We've got our next guest, Tony Collins, hanging on the line. We'll get to Tony on the other side of this quick station break.
You're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari, where NFL legends live on. Back to you, boys.
Hand me the lock.
And now back with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate in his regular weekly time slot is former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. Hey, Tony, how are you tonight?
Hi, Tom. Doing fantastic. How you doing, Chris and Bob?
No, really good. Thank you, Tony.
Good, thank you.
So, Tony, I want to get your thoughts. Here we are. It's in training camp, and we talked a little bit about this with you last week. But wanted to get your memories. No one wants, you know, to when it's after practice and, you know, everyone's eating and all that sort of stuff, and you go back to your dorm room, the last thing anyone wants to hear is a knock at the door, right? Particularly if it's one of the coaches. Because, you know, the next thing you're going to hear is coach wants to see you bring your playbook. How nervous are you guys, particularly, you know, in your first year or two, when you go back at night fearing that the Turk might be knocking on the door any minute?
Well, you know, I was very confident my rookie season. I really was. You know, I got drafted in the second round, and I was having a good camp. And one thing Mosi Tatupu told me, he said, don't get too friendly with all the young guys. I was like, why? Because he said they might not be here. But I was really confident. My roommate that I had, I can't even remember the guy's name right now. I remember he was really nervous because he was kind of low on the depth chart. And I think the second week, maybe second or third week, and we got the knock at the door and it was that call. But you know, it's a crazy time of the year for especially the young guys and some of the guys that are trying to make the team, even the older guys that are, you know, trying to stay on the team, and you're fighting hard every day and you never want to hear that knock at the door. But as for me, I guess I was so confident my rookie season that, and of course I was having a good camp, and I think like the second or third week going into the camp, Horace Ivory got hurt, and so I kind of moved up to second string behind who was it? God, I can't even think of his name now. He's from Notre Dame. Whatever his name was, I can't think of his name. Good running back. I don't know. Vegas Ferguson, that's his name. I was behind Vegas Ferguson. So, you know, I was being real confident. I got a lot of time, and I was returning kickoffs too in preseason. So I was kind of confident.
And Tony, one of the things that we hear people reference a lot is being in quote unquote football shape. Those first few days at camp, when you're coming in and you've been working out, maybe you haven't in the off season, I imagine the body gets pretty sore when all of a sudden you're starting taking, you know, the hits, you know, during practice and, you know, the drills that they're putting you through and all of that sort of thing. What's the body feel like, you know, that first week or two of training camp?
Oh, the first week is definitely first couple of days. You know, you get in the ice tub and kind of get your muscles right. But yeah, you're gonna be sore. I mean, that's a part of it. But if you're in shape, I think that's the best thing. And most guys, most guys come in shape. The big part as a rookie or a player coming from another team maybe is really getting down that playbook and not making mistakes on the practice field. And that's the biggest thing. You know, most guys are in shape, but especially if you're not in shape and you get tired and you miss a play because you're not into the playbook, that's even worse. But so I think the biggest thing is the not the in shape part, but just learning the playbook and being really confident and not making mistakes. Because, you know, as a rookie, you don't get a lot of reps. So every rep that you get, you got to make sure that it's a plus for you. You know, you never want to get any minuses. You want to get all pluses during practice so you'll get an opportunity to play in the game.
Bob, questions for Tony?
Tony, I know you and I have talked about Saquon Barkley a lot since he was drafted, and it's all over the internet tonight. His first carry, he carried the ball for 39 yards. He went into the line, broke away, and just outran a lot of guys. Beyond a special athlete, Tony, and I'm just thinking the way Pat Shurmur can use this guy to try. The whole thing with this guy is if he can stay healthy, that's for sure. I'm sure when he's a franchise player like he is, his health is going to be at the forefront of everything they do. Do you think they'll use him in a way, Tony, that limits his chances to get hurt?
Well, I mean, you really can't do that. You want to use him everywhere because he's the kind of kid that can run out of the backfield. He can catch out of the backfield. He's a good blocker. And I was watching him tonight, even on the runs that he didn't get a lot of yards on. You can tell the kid has all the talent in the world, man. I'm really pulling for this kid. I think he can be a superstar. I mean, I think if he, just like you said, if he stays healthy, he's going to break a lot of records because the kid has all the tools, man. He's got the speed. He's got the size. He's quick. I love watching him play. As a matter of fact, I seen the run because I wanted to see, you know, I knew he was going to play in the first quarter, so I wanted to make sure I got the chance to see him, and I'm impressed.
And I was looking through your old cast of characters in New England. Like, I always like to bring up one of your teammates. One of the guys you've talked about a lot in the past, Tony, Mosi Tatupu. I don't think people realize that this guy was around 14 years. Actually played with the Rams 1 year in 91 at the age of 36. But tell our listeners more about the kind of guy he was, Tony, and why he lasted as long as he did.
Well, he was a professional. I put it to you that way. He was professional on and off the field. And mostly was, you know, when I got there, my locker was right by him. And I'm really thankful for Mosi because he really taught me a whole lot how to make sure you're 5 minutes early to a meeting. Make sure you're never late to a meeting. Make sure you get in the playbook. You know, he was right there letting me know all the things that I should do as a rookie. And I'm very appreciative of Mosi. But like I say, more importantly, off the field, the guy would give you his shirt off his back. And a guy that I missed, I remember my first golf tournament that I had for my foundation, he was there. And the following year, he passed away. And, man, it was such a devastation to a lot of us because, you know, Mosi was that type of guy that, you know, all the good people seemed to leave us too soon. And he was that type of guy that, you know, you would think, man, this guy should live for a long time because he deserves it, you know? Mm-hmm. And, just a fantastic guy, man. A beast on the field and also just a gentleman off the field.
Tony, one more before we let you go. And Sony Michel is expected to miss, it looks like, all of training camp with a knee injury. And you got Le'Veon Bell with the Steelers skipping, you know, training camp again this year. How hard is it to miss all of camp, particularly if you're a guy like Michel, right, a rookie coming in? You know, how hard is it to miss all of camp? And the first real action you're going to see is when we get to the regular season, week one.
That's tough for a rookie. I mean, as a rookie, you want to be in there. You want to play all the preseason games, get your timing down. And for him to be out this early now and going to miss all the whole preseason, I think it's going to be tough for him. But you never know. He could adapt very quickly. But as for your guy, man, Pittsburgh need to give him that money. They need to give him that money. You know, Le'Veon to me is one of the – him and Ty Gurley is probably the best backs in the league right now, hands down. And, they deserve everything that they can get. And, you know, you've seen Le'Veon. I don't know, it's just the third time that he's missed the whole training camp. And he comes out and he gets 1400 yards every year. So maybe he didn't go to training camp. I can't imagine what he would do if he had a full training camp under his belt. And man, and just beat that timing, man. The guy is incredible to me. I think he's the top back in the league, and Pittsburgh needs to treat him right, man. You know, running backs are at this time of the stage of football, a running back now is very, very valuable because they can do so many things to hurt defenses. And Le'Veon's one of those guys. Le'Veon, man. Catch. He can do it all. So you got to give the guy what he's due. And I think this Pittsburgh is cheap, man. That's why they ain't gonna win a Super Bowl in a long time because they're cheap. No.
Wow, we've got both ends of the spectrum here, Bob, with our first two guests. Paul Alexander telling us that the Patriots are done, they're through, and Tony telling me that the Steelers are cheap. So we'll see. We'll see.
See what happens.
Tony, you mentioned your foundation. Tell our listeners about the great things you do with your foundation for kids going to college.
TonyCollinsFoundation.org. We're helping as many kids as we can in the Yates County area in upstate New York get off to college. And just it's been, like I said, we just had our 10-year anniversary this year. And just we just love helping kids and giving back to the community.
Ah, you're fantastic, Tony. Thanks for your time again tonight, my friend. We look forward to catching up with you again next week in between now and then. All the best to you and all of your lovely grandchildren.
God bless, guys.
Take care.
See you, Tony. That is former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. We've got Ricardo McDonald hanging on the line. We're going to get to Ricardo on the other side of this quick station break.
Thursday Night Tailgate, where the spotlight is always on the positive. Tune in Thursday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time to hear your favorite NFL legends, players, and coaches sharing their stories. Now back to Chris and Bob.
I wouldn't joke about anything else that happened to you tonight.
Now joining us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is former Pitt and Cincinnati Bengals linebacker Ricardo McDonald. Let me give you some background on Ricardo. He is from Kingston, Jamaica. Grew up in Paterson, New Jersey. He played his college ball at Pitt. He was a fourth-round draft pick by the Cincinnati Bengals in 1992, and he played in the NFL from 92 to 2001 for the Bengals, Bears, and Broncos. He was named to the 1992 All-Rookie Team. His twin brother, Devon, who's been a wonderful guest here on the show, played on the last Notre Dame team to win the national championship back in 1988, and he played in the NFL for the Colts. And twins have played a huge part in the McDonald family, which we'll talk about here in just a moment. But we're excited to have Ricardo with us tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Ricardo, Chris and Bob here. Thank you for joining us.
Welcome to the show. Welcome. Hello, Chris and Bob. Thank you for having me.
Pleasure.
So, Ricardo, before we get into all the football stuff, and like I mentioned a moment ago, twins are a big part of the McDonald family. Obviously, you and your brother are twins. You have twin children, and I believe Devon's mother-in-law is also part of a twin. She's got a twin sister. So it's got to be unbelievable at the family reunion trying to keep everybody straight.
No, it is. You know, in actuality, the year that my twins were actually born, there was actually two sets of twins that was actually born in my family. But there's more twins born naturally in Jamaica and Africa than anywhere else in the world. And I so there's a product in Jamaica, evidently, it's called yam. Not the yam that's in the U.S., but it's a product that's raised in that's grown in the ground. And I guess that this product is, and you Google it, you're welcome to Google it, and you Google yam and twins, and I guess this product, also is produced in Africa too. And when you do it, when you Google it, the information is quite, enlightening, about how this product be able to help produce twins from this, I guess, from this product itself.
Wow. All right. Have to look that up after the show. and Ricardo, I read growing up, you were a big cricket player. So who got you to put the cricket bat down and start playing American football?
That's a very good question. So my whole life, you know, growing up in the islands, you have to do three things now. So I grew up either running track. There's a big cricket guy named Michael Holden. And I also grew up playing soccer. I wanted to be Pele. So upon embarking into the United States, I saw my cousin on the streets of Patterson run around, and they're catching this ball, and they're calling it football. And I'm like, God, how on earth is this football? And you guys are catching it with a hand. So I was arguing my cousin, I'm like, this is handball. And they're like, no, this is football. And he's like, no, this is football. I'm like, no, this is handball. And so, anyway, my twin brother went out. We were about 13 years old, and my twin brother went out the first day of football. And about a week and a half later, I guess the coach saw me walking in the hallway, and he said, oh, you got a twin brother. And so, anyway, the coach invited me to come to practice, and I went out, and so I'm sitting down at practice, and I'm watching these guys hitting each other, And they get back up and they would do this rah-rah speech. And I'm like, this has to be the craziest thing I've ever seen in my entire life. And you guys call this fun? And so I looked at my twin brother and I said, the whole time during practice, I'm like, you've been doing this for a week now and you'd like this? And he's like, oh my God, this is like the best thing ever. And so to where I was doing a practice, coach looked at me and he's like, well, what do you think? And I was like, coach, I have no idea what I'm doing out here. I see these guys, they've been hitting each other all day. This ball, this crazy ball is in the air. These guys are catching it. And I had no idea. He said, well, why don't we maybe put some pads on you? We're about to do this last drill called Bull in the Ring. And I was like, sure. So towards the end of practice, the coach is like, well, we're doing this thing called Bull in the Ring. And the low man went. So I'm watching these guys, you know, he's yelling out Johnson Smith. And these guys are like hitting each other like two rams, like, you know, running towards each other. Anyway, so towards this drill is going on for about maybe 10, 15 minutes. And he yells out R. McDonald, which is Ricardo McDonald, and this guy named Blunt. And this kid hit me so hard in my sternum. It was the first near-death experience I ever had in my entire life. So I'm on the ground flopping around like a fish. And I feel like I'm about to die. And the coach walked over to me and he said, well, son, you just got the wind knocked out of you. He said, well, I said, coach, I want to thank you so much for this opportunity. But I will never, ever play this game ever again. And I took my pads off and walked off the football field. My twin brother looked at me and said, Devon, he said, Ricardo, you can't quit. And I'm like, look, I went back and I joined the soccer team the next day. And about a week later, the coach came to my house and they had this big event that my mom, the dad, the coach, and everybody. And the coach walked in and he said something to me. He said, if you allow me to teach you this game of football, American football, it'll take you farther in life that your mom and dad will never allow, have to pay for you to go to college. And I believe that this game could take you very far in life. And so I started learning how to tackle, like literally from my knees. And the gentleman was a guy by the name of this thing called Lou Mathis. And so one of the things that I channeled even today in one of my foundation is I talked to a lot of parents about how believing in a kid, even though a lot of kids don't even have a belief in themselves. And so for the 10 seconds until I got knocked out, this coach saw something in me. And he believed in me, even though I didn't believe in myself. And that says a lot about a lot of parents not giving up on a kid. Because this coach could have easily said, hey, I got about 75 other guys on the team. This is another kid who don't know the game of football. I'm just going to move on. But he took the time to teach me the game of football. And I thanked him for it.
So from there, Ricardo, and I'm from Pittsburgh, so I couldn't be more thrilled that you played at Pitt. Talk about the schools that recruited you and why you chose to go play at Pitt.
It's a good question. So we came out, so I visited the University of Miami. My twin brother at the same weekend visited, I think he visited Illinois that weekend. The weekend I went to go visit Miami. Miami back then was the Alabama, you know, so there was 25 guys that came on official visits. There was another 10 guys that came on unofficial visits. There was 4 guys from New Jersey that actually went down with me. By the time we boarded that flight that Sunday, Jimmy Johnson was actually still the head coach at University of Miami. All 4 of those guys had committed to UM. And so they asked me, what was I going to do? I said, well, I still got a visit set up to Syracuse, and I still got a visit set up to the University of Pittsburgh. And so my twin brother, I came back that Sunday. My twin brother came back. He went out to Notre Dame the next week, and I went to Syracuse the following week. And we both came back home, and he said, well, I'm going to go to Notre Dame. And he said, well, what did you think? What did you think about Syracuse? And I said, well, I don't think that's a place for me. Well, the next week he went to Penn State, and I went out to the University of Pittsburgh. And there's a guy by the name of Craig Arnett Hayward who took me on my visit. And there's a head coach named Mike Gottfried who looked at me. And he said, now there's only four guys that ever started as true freshmen. Bill Fraley, Tony Dorsett, Dan Marino, and a guy named Duke Green. And we think that you could be our next true freshman that ever started. And that's all I wanted to hear. And I said, Coach, if you call my mom and tell her that, I'll sign the letter of intent right now. He picked up the phone and called my house and told my mom that I had the opportunity to start against Ohio State Buckeyes the first week in 1989. And I signed with the Pitt Panthers.
Five questions for Ricardo? Go ahead.
And so the one thing that I never did, I never not believed in myself. And so even though I was two years out of high school, and I still didn't know the game of American football, the one thing that I had that kept ringing in my bell was getting that feeling of having me being knocked out 2 years earlier from the that first bull in the ring. And so I channeled the panel in the fact that I was going to be to have to play with the most intensity. And that's what I brought to the game of football, was the intensity and the tenacity to be able to do that. If you were standing, I was literally trying to separate it from it, from the head from the body.
Five questions for Ricardo.
Yeah, Ricardo, more about your relationship with Devon. Great guy. I mean, you guys just had so much success at such a young age. And we hear about the closeness of twins all the time. Was there any a lot of competitiveness between the two of you as you continue to excel up the football ladder?
You know what? And that's the problem. You know, that was one of the things that, you know, and looking back at it, that I regret with my twin brother. You know, one of the things with twin boys is that they're highly competitive. I mean, me and Devon competed at everything in life, and twin boys are like that. They're very, very competitive. I mean, if my twin brother made the honor roll and I didn't talk to him for a couple of months, and vice versa. If Devon had 15 tackles and three sacks and two interceptions, I was mad. I wanted to outdo him, and that's how it always was. It was always a competitive nature. To see who could outdo who. And part of the problem that it created was we didn't know how that once we got off the football field that it was just a game. That even after the football game that we still competed at just about everything in life. It was always about competition to see who was the smartest. To see who was this, to see who was that. And it wasn't until we probably maybe got out the NFL that our bond and our relationship kind of grew in a much different, way. And the love between us transcended in a different, trajectory. And I think part of it too is that we grew from a spiritual standpoint in a direction in which it, our wives, our family, and it was more so cohesive unit, more so than the competitive nature that when we were a lot younger.
And Ricardo, taking you back to the 92 draft, I looked at some of the linebackers taken ahead of you. You had guys like Quentin Coriot and LaVon Kirkland, our good friend, but, You were pretty high up there in linebackers. I wanted to get your expectations. What do you remember about that draft?
So going up to the draft, one of the things about the draft was that leading up to it, I was probably rated on a couple of the reports that I was like literally up to rated in the company Sports Illustrated. Even back then, I was like one of the top three linebackers. And for some odd reason, you know, I dropped part of it was the fact that I was pretty much a rush end. And I think even back then, a lot of the linebackers that they were looking for, kind of like a Quentin Corriott, who could drop in the coverage. And I had played in a Hula Bowl with, LeVon Kirkland, part of Clemson. And Marvin Lewis, who had coached me at the University of Pittsburgh and went to, the Steelers the year before. I kind of felt a little bit jaded by them not drafting me in the Steelers. And so even that, when I went to Cincinnati, I kind of had a little bit of a chip on my shoulder, so to speak. And so I played with like a little bit of anger every time I played against the Steelers. You know, and the fact that, you know, yeah, I was a linebacker. You were a linebacker coach. I mean, you had me for two years, and you drafted a linebacker from out of Clemson. And part of the reason why I knew because, you know, they were looking for a different kind of a linebacker. They were looking for someone who was more versatile, dropping in the coverage, where I was pretty much a rush guy that was pretty much trying to get after the quarterback.
Ricardo, one more before we let you go. We've got our next guest, Al Oliver, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Al in just a moment. But
sure.
When I looked over your Wikipedia page, it says that you suffered at least 20 concussions, and that one doctor said to you on one of them that your brain was 60% swollen. You played anyway, got another concussion on top of that. Talk about, you know, everything now that we're learning about CTE and all of that sort of thing. You know, looking back at all of the concussions that you had, are you worried at all about what life could be like down the road?
Well, you know, I've been diagnosed with what's called, partial dementia. I've also been, diagnosed with, hydrocephalus, which is basically excessive fluid on the brain. I've lost a lot of, brain volume. There's a lot of portion of my brain of atrophy as a result of the trauma that my brain has suffered. For the game of football, you know, it's been very good. You know, do I have regrets about it? I think if I was 18 years old and I had the knowledge that I do today, I probably would not have went down this road because I have a son right now who's 12 and I refuse to let him play. I have a son who's 18 years old who just got a scholarship to Nebraska and playing football and I beg him not to. Not to. You know, because of the simple fact that, I beg him not to because of the simple fact that I think that once you have information and you're able to have all the information and the resources and you're able to have all the ill effect of what this information and how damaging it can cause. And especially when you have good friends. I got a good friend of mine right now that I used to play ball with, that has, that's no longer here. Kevin Turner, out of Alabama, that died from ALS about two years ago. I've got some good friends of mine who have had dementia. We're dealing with onset of dementia right now. And so I've seen the ill effect that 45-year-old men don't have dementia in the natural world. So when you look at the general population, things that show up maybe in the 70s or 80s in the general population show up a lot earlier in life in men who play very physical sport, like the American football. And so, you know, armed with that kind of information, I would never subject, not even my worst enemy, to that. And so I've swayed about my son. My son's away from me.
Ricardo, before we let you go, how can our listeners stay up to date with what you're doing? Is there a way to follow you on social media?
Yeah. I am. I'm on Instagram. That's RicoMac at Instagram.com.
God. Well, Ricardo, thank you so much for taking time out of your night, and we thank our good friend Randy Fuller for getting us connected. We hope you'll come back and join us again sometime. Sure. A lot more questions we'd like to get into, and unfortunately just didn't have enough time tonight, but we hope you'll do it again sometime.
Okay, likewise. Thank you so much.
Take care, Ricardo.
All right, take care, Ricardo.
Good to know.
That is Ricardo McDonald, former Cincinnati Bengals linebacker and University of Pittsburgh linebacker as well. Bob, you know, a lot of good stories, and there's a lot of great things between he and his twin brother, Devon. But when you read his Wikipedia page and you hear or you read all about the concussions, boy, it sure is a scary thing.
Sure is, Chris. You had brought it up earlier, and, you know, we're just glad he could give us the time he did, and he sounds terrific. We just hope the best for him. And when he brought up Kevin Turner's name, we all know about
that.
He's close and dear to our show. So, again, we'll have more to talk to him in the future, I'm sure. It's a fascinating topic, and he has a fascinating life.
All right, coming up here in the rest of hour number two here on Thursday Night Tailgate, we're going to be joined by Al Oliver and Olandis Gary. Before Al joins us, I want to give a shout-out to our friends over at the Gridiron Greats organization. Folks, please help support a wonderful cause. It's taking care of the guys who left so much of themselves out on the field. These are the guys who played way back when they still had to get off-season jobs to help support themselves and their families. And, again, it's organizations like this one that Mike Ditka started. Again, they're called the Gridiron Greats, who are trying to help these guys we all grew up watching and reading about. Please go online to gridirongreats.org to see how you can get involved. All right, now back with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is one of the greatest hitters of all time, and that's Al Oliver. Let me remind you about Al's background. He is from Portsmouth, Ohio, and which is down in the southern part of the state, just across the river from Kentucky. Signed by the Pirates as an amateur free agent in 1964 and played in the majors from 1968 to 1985 for the Pirates, Rangers, Expos, Giants, Phillies, Dodgers, and Blue Jays. He's a lifetime batting average of .303, had 2,743 hits, 219 home runs, and he drove in 1,326 runs. He was a seven-time All-Star. He won the Silver Slugger Award three times, won the National League batting title in 1982 when he led the league in hits, RBIs, extra base hits, doubles, and runs created. And I've said this every time Al has joined the show, and as a Pirates fan, as a kid who grew up in Pittsburgh back in the 1970s, Al forever lives in the hearts of Pirates fans for his 10 years in Pittsburgh, helping the Pirates win five division titles and the 1971 World Series. Should be in the Hall of Fame. You know, how a guy that played that many seasons in the Major League with a lifetime batting average over .300 isn't in the Hall is a mystery to both Bob and I, but we are honored he is back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Al, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming back
on
the show.
Welcome back, Al.
Hey, gentlemen, how you guys doing?
Oh, we're fantastic. Al, how have you been?
I've been doing good. You know, I've really been staying busy. You know, this has been a very busy month for me. You know, I got back to Johnstown over the weekend. I went up there to speak for them on their Hall of Fame induction. They had inducted three new players in their Hall of Fame. So I was a guest speaker this year. And, of course, next week I'm going to Kansas City. They're having a Buck O'Neill Celebrity Golf Tournament in which I'm not a golfer, but I still can tell the story and ride the cart. And then the week after that, I'll be going back to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
There you go.
So it's been a busy year.
Alan, I wanted to start our time with you tonight talking about, you know, as a member of those 1970s Pirates teams, and we recently lost a key member of that team in Bruce Keeson. I wanted to try to get some of the things that you remember about playing alongside with Bruce.
Well, I remember him very well. And ironically, this year at the Pittsburgh Pirates Fantasy Camp, we were co-managers together. And all week long, he had problems with his back. He had a hard time sitting down. He had a hard time getting up. I mean, he was in a lot of pain. And I said, Buster, you need to go home and get some rest. But he showed up every morning. That's just the way he was. He was a gamer. And then, unfortunately, 2 weeks after the camp was over, I got a call, you know, from the Pirates front office saying that they had found something. I believe it was a tumor, and it was cancerous. And I can honestly say, being with him all week, I was really not surprised, because I've never seen a guy in so much pain. But as a pitcher, we loved to see him on the mound, because we knew that if any of us went down, he had our back. But the problem with that was, when he was pitching, he might send somebody on the other team to the campus, and then we would have to pay. So it was a two-way street. And he was real fiery, too. He was not afraid of nobody. You know, you could always ask Mike Smith that, when Mike Smith charged him on the mound one time, and Bruce whipped some kind of move on him and made a good connection. But as a pitcher, he was one great competitor. As a person, he had a great sense of humor. He probably had the best Al Arbor stories that you can imagine. He could mock me better than any teammate probably does that I ever had. And I'm just glad that I had the opportunity this year in the Pirate Fantasy Camp to co-manage with him, because when I left the camp, I did not know I would never see him again. So you got to enjoy yourself while you're together. And that's what we did on those teams in the early 70s.
And Al, you played in your first All-Star game in 1972. You had you, Willie Stargell, Roberto Clemente, Manny Sanguine, Steve Blass, all made that 72 All-Star team. And you took over in right field for Hank Aaron later in the game. But that National League All-Star team, Willie Mays was out there, a half dozen other guys who ended up in the Hall of Fame. What was it like being in the same locker room and playing on a team for at least one night filled with those guys?
Well, it was a treat. And, you know, I can honestly say, you know, I was one of those guys that most people know who started my career. You know, I've always been a very positive guy, a very confident guy. But one thing that I knew that night, of course, that with that outfield, I would not be starting. And so common sense prevailed that night. And I remember Danny Murtaugh being our manager, you know, after we had won 71 World Championship team. He says, "Scoop, I want you to go out and take Hank's place once he gets out the right field." And I did. I replaced him. And it's the only time in my career I can honestly say that I felt good, and I was honored to have had an opportunity to replace Hank Aaron in an All-Star game.
And now you talk about Bruce Keeson and, you know, dusting guys and stuff like that. Bob Gibson started that game, you know, for you guys in the All-Star game, but you must have faced Gibson dozens of times. What was it like stepping to the plate against him?
Well, see, the advantage that I had, I was left-handed, and I had very good success against him. I think I hit 340-something against him, career. The Hall of Fame pitchers, I never had any problems with. The only Hall of Fame pitcher that I can recall where I had a low batting average was Steve Carlton. A friend of mine had wrote down 20 Hall of Famers and what I hit against them. And Carlton, I thought it was a misprint, but if I'm not mistaken, I hit 195 against Steve Carlton. And I told my PR guy, I said, "Look, you got to recheck that. That's a misprint. I've never hit 195 against nobody." So, but what Steve could do, Steve made me hit his pitches consistently. I was a guy that I didn't do a lot of striking out. And if a pitcher knows that, he knows he has to make good pitches. And Steve consistently made good pitches against me. And that's the reason why he had the success against me that he did. And you're right about Bob Gibson. I felt sorry for those right-hand hitters. I'm glad that I was on the left side against them.
Bob, questions for Al?
Al, it's always an honor to speak with you, and welcome back. I was watching a few games this week, Al, and I'm thinking of your era and how it's changed, and we've talked about this ad nauseum. But one of the things I was seeing was guys using iPads and looking at swings during games and things like this. And I'm thinking back when Al Oliver was playing, I'm not even sure they had batting coaches. I know they didn't have the technology, but there had to be coaches along the way, Al, that probably helped you out a little bit with your swing or gave you some tips. Can you mention some of those guys?
Well, in Pittsburgh, you know, there was Bob Skinner. And when I went to Montreal, Billy DeMars, who was our hitting coach, and they never really bothered me as far as a hitter, but there was one area that they would always let me know if I was ever pulling off the ball, you know, being pull conscious, because I always went into the pitch, you know, like Gibson and Marichal and Gaylord, all those guys that he always dove into the ball, and that's why he got hit all the time. So they felt that the outside was there. And I said, what's wrong with you pitchers? You know, but that's just the way they thought. And so only Dave Cass said it best. To be a hitting coach for the Pirates, the only thing that you can say, that's the way to hit the ball. So they had an easy job. Coaching us in Pittsburgh, because we all could hit. And as long as we didn't try to pull the ball, we were fine.
And Al, I had so many questions for you, but one of the things I was thinking about, you had mentioned it earlier, you didn't strike out much, and for our baseball fans that are listening, it's kind of mind-boggling that the most Al Oliver ever struck out was 59 times, and oh, by the way, he won a batting title that year in 82, but it's such a different game, Al. Guys are striking out 59 times a month almost these days, and it's not a big deal. And I have arguments, Al, that people say, well, if you strike out or pop up, what's the difference? But putting on the bat on the ball meant a lot to you. And tell our listeners why you think you just didn't like to strike out.
Well, it was just something that I had in me, you know, from the time I started playing ball. Especially organized ball in no league. You know, I always had the confidence factor that I could hit any pitcher. And hitting, to me, was a gift from God. It was something that I really never had to work that hard. It was just something that I had. But the one thing about my hitting, I never took it for granted. I still took batting practice. I didn't take a lot of batting practice because I really didn't believe in taking a lot of batting practice. My thing was, with the mindset that I had, when I did strike out, I was mad. And the same thing holds true for all my teammates, too. It was just amazing how everybody on the team did not like to make an out. And no time in the history of baseball has anyone ever hit 1,000. But we thought we thought that we could do it. And today, when I see these guys take fastballs for a called third strike, looking at it, I turn the channel to Perry Mason.
Don't blame.
That's one of my favorite shows, man. I tell you what, and Jeopardy. But it's hard to believe that they've gone through this, what they call launch angle, and what that means is to pull the ball. So what do you do with the outside pitch? If you're trying to pull the ball and a good pitcher who's on the mound, the only thing he has to do is throw the ball away from you, and it's really not much you can do. And I don't know who started the launch angle, but I don't think it's good, because what happened, like we were talking about, there are so many strikeouts. It's unbelievable. The strikeout, it's either a strikeout or a home run. And that's been a lot of both.
Al, I'm curious to find out why you decided to retire when you did. When I look back at your stats, I mean, at 37 years old, 1984, you still hit 301. And you were productive again in 85. So for a guy who is less than 300 hits shy of 3,000, boy, I would have guessed some American League team could have used a DH like you. Why did you leave after the 85 season?
Well, the problem was I did leave. They sent me home. It was that was
what
you recall after that baseball. The game of baseball stopped Al Oliver's career. Because at the end of 1985 season, if you look back and remember, that was when they found the owner guilty of collusion. And that is what stopped my career. Because I easily had four or five more years left in the tank. Because I really hadn't slowed up at all. I took a run. I took a hit. And for the DH, I could have easily made, you know, some team a real good DH and fit right in and help some team win. Just like I was doing at Toronto, you know, when I played my last game. So it was the fact that baseball sent me home because I was not near ready to leave the game. I just wished that they would allow my ability to dictate when I was done, but I never got that opportunity.
Help me understand, though. Why would they send you home? Why would a team not want a good player like you? What was behind it?
I don't know. It's a question that it's hard for me to answer. And what makes that so difficult for me personally, regardless of where I go, regardless of what state I'm in, people ask me, why aren't you in the Hall of Fame?
Yeah.
And I said, I really don't know. And what really amazes me more than anything else, and my grandson was just talking, and my grandson, who's 19, said this to me 3 days ago. He said, people, the Hall of Fame is not important anymore. And for him to say that, I knew what he meant by that. You know, he knows what his people did. But what I don't understand is this war, this OPS, analytics, sabermetrics, I have no idea what that means. But I do know one thing. It helps some players and hurts other players. But maybe one day somebody will be able to explain that to me, and then I have a better understanding of what it means. It is so much that's going on. You know, you never know what they're talking about in meetings. You just don't know what they're saying. But the most important thing with me, you know, I'm not angry about it. Because I knew and I know what I did. I feel good about what I did. And I know who I am. It's just the fact that I just didn't get the opportunity that my ability called for. That's the only drawback. you know, because a lot of people just didn't know basically what we're talking about now, they thought I had retired, but no team had no interest in signing me, and I was just in Johnstown last weekend. And they said, you know, why wouldn't the Pirates bring you back to finish your career? And that's when I had to explain to them that all of baseball was under collusion. And there were some players that they sent home, like myself and Rob Peru. And then there were other players like the Andre Dawson, the guys who were a little younger than I. They were trying to cut back on their salary. So that's what happened to Al Oliver. Baseball sent me home, and I've been home ever since, and I've moved on with my life.
Well, Al, we can't thank you enough for taking time out of your night to come back and be a part of the show. We know you've got a busy schedule. Let our listeners know, where can they find Al Oliver in the next couple of months?
Well, they go to my website, of course, and that pretty much states where I want to be. Of course, I'll be at the Kansas City Negro Museum next week. They're having a celebrity golf tournament for Buck O'Neill, and I'm going there for that. And then after that, I'm going to Pittsburgh. The following weekend, I'll be in Pittsburgh. And so that's pretty much my schedule for the rest of this month. But my website usually lets you know where I'll be. And it's easy to get to. You just go to AlOliver.com, and it will show you pretty much my whole career, my bio, and kind of what my life has been like, and things that I'm doing these days, and the type of topics that I like to speak on when I do my motivational speaking.
Wow, thank you so much for your time tonight and coming back. We hope we get the opportunity to have you back on the show again real soon. You're fantastic. You're one of our favorites, and we can't thank you enough, and we look forward to, like I say, hopefully getting to have you back before too long.
Okay, you guys take care.
Thank you, Al.
All right. Thanks, Al.
All right, you're welcome. All right.
That's a great Al Oliver. And Bob, you know, any guy that batted over 300 over an 18-year career, had nearly 3,000 hits, should be in the Hall of Fame.
Oh, no question, Chris. A guy who had consistency like few others did for, you know, at least a 10, 11, 12-year, whatever number you want to put on it. And, again, he was a victim of some bad luck. I mean, I told you before, in the 82 season, Chris, where he won the batting title, he led the league in RBIs, hits, total bases, and won a batting title, came in third in the MVP. So Al knows what it's like. But, you know, he goes on, and I think he, in his heart, he knows that a lot of big baseball fans like me and you know he belongs. And maybe that's good enough for him, and he continues to do great things.
Yeah, he does. And I tell you, and we've got our next guest, Olandis Gary, hanging on. I'm going to get to Olandis in just a second. Here's you know, just another head scratcher, you know, when you think about all the great things that Al did, right? And you look over those statistics, and even if you want to take a step back and you say, well, you know, he finished 56th all-time in career hits. Okay, 55 other guys in the history of Major League Baseball got more hits than Al Oliver did. Hey, I mean, that to me, that just adds, you know, just layer upon layer of how ridiculous it is. And to think, Bob, in his first time on the ballot, less than 5% of the voters voted him into the Hall of Fame, and he didn't come back on the ballot again. I mean, that's just really, really.
Yeah.
Only 5% of the baseball writers look at a guy with 2,700 hits. Batted 303 for his career, played 18 years in the league, and only 5% of them thought that was good enough to even be considered for the Hall of Fame. Come on, man. That's just absolutely nuts to me, Bob.
And this is why you can't have a conversation about the Hall of Fame without getting an emotional aspect to it, Chris. There's just so much politics and so many arguments, and it's crazy. You know, there's guys that are in there that don't belong. There's so many that are looking out, looking inside. I mean, it's, again, we can go on all day long. We talk about football players. We have them on all the time that should be in. But Al, I just hope someday some of these younger people think, my goodness, that was a great player. Let's get on a crusade to get him in.
Yeah, agree with that statement. All right, now back in making his sixth appearance with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is Olandis Gary. Let me remind you about Olandis's background. He's from Washington, D.C. He played his first 2 years of college ball at Marshall and then transferred to the University of Georgia, where he played his final 2 seasons. And over those 2 seasons, he rushed for nearly 1,100 yards and 17 touchdowns. And those 17 touchdowns put him in the top 5 in the SEC both seasons. He was a fourth-round draft pick by the Denver Broncos in 1999 and burst onto the scene his rookie year after he replaced an injured Terrell Davis. He rushed for 1,159 yards and 7 touchdowns. He played in the league from 99 to 2004 with the Broncos and the Lions, and over that time averaged 4 yards per carry and 7 yards per reception. In 99, he was the Week 15 Offensive Player of the Week, and we're honored that he is back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Olandis, Chris and Bob, thanks for coming back on the
show. Welcome back.
Hey, fellas, thanks for having me. I appreciate it. How's it going?
No, it's fantastic. Thank you. So, Olandis, I want to start by getting your thoughts on your alma mater, the University of Georgia, right? All eyes are going to be on them this season, see if they can get back to a national championship game. But first things first, you got to win the SEC East to get there. Do you think anybody in the East is going to challenge Georgia this season?
We definitely will be challenged. And we actually have an early challenge in University of South Carolina. I think, you know, they're doing some great things down there with our Will, our Must Champ. So that's definitely an early challenge for us. And, you know, it's always tough when you're playing teams like Tennessee, in a conference. So you never know. And Florida, I mean, they look like they're doing some good things as well. So, I think the East is getting stronger and stronger, you know, with the coaches that are coming into the league now. So, I definitely think we'll be challenged in the East, and it's definitely going to be a dog fight going forward.
And Olandis, now with Nick Chubb and Sony Michel both in the NFL, who's the next great University of Georgia running back? You have such a lineage of great running backs year after year after year. Who's the next guy?
Yeah, there are a couple. I watched him a little bit. Vander Holyfield's son. I think he's going to come on. Elijah Holyfield, he's going to come on strong this year for us. And then, you know, there's a freshman that's going to play as well. So, we have a few other guys that I think that's going to hold the fort down for us there.
And Olandis, when you look at a guy like Jake Fromm, really good freshman year, obviously getting Georgia to the title game and nearly won it. But Georgia also brought in the number one quarterback recruit in the country in Justin Fields. So you've got two really good quarterbacks. A great problem for Kirby Smith to have, right? But if you're going to have a problem, hey, I got too many good quarterbacks now on my roster. You think Fields is going to stick around? Will he sit 3 years behind Fromm?
I don't know if he has to, you know. Me and my son, we were talking in the car on our way home, and, the old saying, if you have two quarterbacks, you have none. I think we're bucking that one. I think we have two great quarterbacks. And, you know how it is, but, you know, being from that state, being in Georgia, those guys, they lived it, you know, their whole lives. So it's not just a university to them, you know, it's a way of life. So I think they can coexist. Hopefully, you know, for us, because they're both of them are excellent talent. So, hopefully they can coexist and, you know, find a way to figure it out to get them guys on the field the same, you know, together or, you know, getting them both some opportunity to play football at that level.
So is anything short of a return to the national championship game, is that a failed season at this point?
I would say so, just because expectations are so high. Last year, you know, people would come up to me and, tell me how sorry they felt for me and all this. And, to me, it was a great season because I took my family down last summer and, you know, the conversations we were having then that I was having with Kirby and, some of the coaches, the national championship was not in the picture, you know, so, you know, just to be able to get there and, we played well, fell off late, but, you know, I think those guys, like you said, we're a year under their belt and, going to the national championship game, I don't think, you know, they're looking for nothing less. And, it also bodes well with the recruiting class that we're having right now.
Bob, questions for Olandis?
Olandis, as a former running back, we've been getting, we're talking a lot tonight about Saquon Barkley here in New York, and I don't think we've talked to you since he got drafted, and get your thoughts. What do you know about him, Olandis? What do you see from him coming on, and how does a guy with quads that big run so fast?
Man, I love him, as a running back, and I don't know him personally, of course, but you know, you can see things, you know, from interviews, you glean, different things, that he says. And, he says all the right things, I mean, the kid is polished. You know, I think, I mean, he's ready for that New York market. I mean, he's a star, starting to make it. And I think his first carry went for like 40-something yards is unbelievable. You know, I'm looking for big things. And like you said, I mean, I'm looking for him to get a gold jacket, you know, after his, what is it, 4 or 5 years after he retired from the NFL.
And speaking of rookies, Olandis, your rookie year we've talked about before too was a magical one. You rushed close to 300 times, and that kind of workload at the pro level compared to anything you ever had done must have been something. How did you feel after that end of that first year? I know you're young and everything, but that's a big workload for a young guy, Olandis.
Yeah, I mean, and you learn fast, and you said at the end, I was on a radio show last week. We were talking, you know, about injuries and things like that. And, you know, when my first game when I played at Denver, I suffered a turf toe injury. And, you know, so that, you know, having to play through that for about the next 4 or 5 weeks, you know, just laboring through that was tough as well. So, I mean, when you're in the league, I mean, you always got to, you know, certain things that you can play with and, you know, nicks, you know, that you have to play through. But, you know, I didn't never know how important a big toe was until I had, plantar fasciitis. I mean, it was unbelievable. But, you know, we changed cleats and things like that. And, certain things that helped me to smooth out the pain a little bit.
Olandis, switching gears a little bit to the Broncos, curious to get your thoughts on their chances this year and Case Keenum now as he has taken over as quarterback there.
You know, for them, I I'm looking at it from afar. You know, I'm not an insider. But, you know, the things that I've been hearing is that, you know, that it seems like he has the team. And, you know, that's the most important thing. You know, for a leader, you know, of that caliber, you know, at in Denver, you know, when a quarterback has the team and, you know, everyone's going on, you know, on the same page, I think, you know, it bodes well for them, you know, and, you know, they have a good receiving core there. And, you know, so they'll definitely look to throw the ball, you know, a lot, you know, what they have there. So, I'm definitely looking for some big things out of the Broncos this year.
And Olandis, you know, we talked about some of the running backs that are in the league now. Obviously, Saquon Barkley a moment ago with Bob. But growing up, who were some of the running backs you idolized and you tried to emulate?
Oh, that's a great question. You know, my favorite. Well, the guy I idolized was Walter Payton, Tony Dorsett, and my favorite running back was Eric Dickerson. He's a different style. And, you know, I just love, you know, he ran high, but he, you know, he got low when he needed to. And, you know, he just always did everything that, you know, he wasn't the fastest, but he's always fast enough. You know, he wasn't the strongest, but he was strong enough. So, you know, something about ED. And then, you know, the face mask, it was, you know, everyone had a Eric Dickerson face mask. I mean, they still do some form of it today with the new, you know, with the new helmet. But, you know, just having that Eric Dickerson face mask, you know, back in the day was just unbelievable. So, I mean, he was my favorite was, Eric Dickerson.
How about other guys that are in the league now? Who are some of the running backs you enjoy watching?
Now I don't, you know, watch too much football right now, you know, to be truthfully honest. But, you know, to me, when I watch it, you know, the game to me is more cerebral than anything. So, I don't, you know, when I played and I wasn't dressed and I was the guy that, I had to know what the plays were just so I can be involved in the game. So now, you know, when I don't know a play or, you know, I have to wait until the play is over and then try to rethink everything that everyone did in that play, you know, just to figure it out, you know, what was going on. It's kind of tough. So, now, I don't watch too much, too many guys now, but, you know, with Saquon coming in, you know, Sony and Nick Chubb now, you know what I mean? Those are the guys that I will be watching now, you know, because I have, I kind of have that Georgia tie with Chubb and, Sony. But, you know, so, but, you know, I'm watching, you know, the younger guys now more so than you know, the guys that are in the league.
Olandis, before we let you go, remind our listeners what you're doing now and how they can follow you both online and on social media.
Oh, definitely. I'm full-time dad, you know, working, just enjoy, you know, enjoying my family. Like you said, I'm in the Washington, D.C. area. And all social media, it's Olandis Gary at everything. So, you know, wherever you guys are, that's where my handle is, Olandis Gary.
You remember that?
Well, Olandis, thank you so much for taking time out of your night to come back and be a part of the show. Always great for Bob and I to get to spend some time with you. We hope you'll come back during the season, share more of your stories and insights
love
with us.
Love talking to you.
I appreciate it, fella. Thanks for having me. And, you know, yeah, I was talking about Hall of Fame earlier. I mean, it kind of got me going because, you know, just thinking about, you know, the guys that I played with, you know, it's just unbelievable that, you know, those guys are starting to go into the Hall now. So, you know, it's unbelievable. And, you know, guys like Champ Bailey, Terrell just got in last year. Randy Moss was the guy that I played, you know, well, when I left Marshall, he was coming to Marshall. So, you know, just, you know, those different ties. So it is a very emotional thing. But I definitely feel your pain, you know, with a lot of guys that, you know, that didn't get in. So.
Well, thank you for that, Olandis. Take care, my friend. We'll catch up again with you soon. In between now and then, all the best to you and your family.
Appreciate it. Thanks for having me, fellas.
Take care.
All right. Take care, Olandis. That is former University of Georgia and Denver Broncos running back Olandis Gary. And Bob, you look back over the time when he came into the league, and a guy that really, like I say, you know, burst onto the scene. You get a guy like Terrell Davis. I'm sure the guys in Denver, their hearts sank when Terrell goes down. But all of a sudden, Olandis Gary comes in and he gives you nearly 1,200 yards, 7 touchdowns. Boy, it's hard to put. Now you got both those guys, right? So kudos to Olandis for being a guy who really stepped up big when he got an opportunity.
Love watching those old Bronco teams, Chris. I'm looking at some of the stats. You know, McCaffrey and Rod Smith had over 100 catches apiece one year. And Mike Anderson, the former military guy, he was in that back. I mean, it was a fun crew to watch. And we'll talk more about his teammates next time he comes on.
All right, when Bob and I come back, we'll be turning on the Thursday Night Tailgate Spotlight on the positive. Hear which players are doing great things in their communities, and then we're going to wrap up the show, and we're going to do that on the other side of these words about our friends at the Salt Creek Golf Retreat and at DP Quality Foods.
If you're looking for a great place for your annual golf outing, a weekend golf getaway, or just a round of golf with your buddy, then Salt Creek Golf Retreat is just what you're looking for. Centrally located in Nashville, Indiana, just south of Indianapolis and west of Cincinnati, this challenging but fair 18-hole golf course appeals to all skill levels, and its scenic views of rolling hills and tree-lined fairways are sure to make golfing memories for years to come. Owned and operated by former Purdue and New York Giants fullback Randy Manier, Salt Creek Golf Retreat offers stay-and-play packages that include golf and a fully furnished one- or two-bedroom condo. After your round, be sure to stop by the 19th hole sports bar and restaurant for great food, fun, and drinks. Randy and his staff will treat you like family. For more information, log on to saltcreekgolf.com. That's saltcreekgolf.com. Or give them a call at 812-558-5944. Salt Creek Golf Retreat. Start making your golfing memories today.
Most folks are familiar with Dan Pastorini's accomplishments on the football field or in race cars. But what most don't know? Dan's family background in the restaurant business. For 37 years, Dan's parents, Dante and Dorothy, owned and operated Pastorini's Longhorn Restaurant. So the Pastorini family has a long history of making great-tasting food from family recipes. Dan and his partners want to bring some of that to you with their Texas-style rub, Texas-style hickory rub, and their garlic and herb seasoning.
first introduced back in 2011, Dan's Texas Style Rub immediately began winning awards, taking home the first place trophy for best ribs at the Pasadena Livestock Show and Barbecue Cook-Off. They did it again at the 2012 Texas Ranger Wounded Warrior Cook-Off, and the awards just keep on coming. Check out Dan's line of spices online at dpqualityfoods.com. That's dpqualityfoods.com. And take what you put on the grill to a whole new level.
Thursday Night Tailgate, where the spotlight is always on the positive. Tune in Thursday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time to hear your favorite NFL legends, players, and coaches sharing their stories. Now back to Chris and Bob.
I wouldn't joke about anything else that happened to you tonight.
Hey, we are back here on Thursday Night Tailgate, and we're turning on our spotlight on the positive. Bob, who are you putting your spotlight on tonight?
This week, Chris, I want to recognize Titans cornerback Logan Ryan and his wife, Ashley. It's pretty cool, Chris. Last weekend was the first time Titan fans could go watch the team play in an intra-squad scrimmage. But the same day, Chris, they had the first – first of all, let me preface it by saying Logan Ryan and his wife, they run an animal rescue foundation called RARF, Ryan Animal Rescue Foundation. And that same day as their first scrimmage, they also, the two of them hosted, they called it the first ever pup rally at Nissan Stadium down in Nashville. Again, there were 16 families that actually came to the game and to this event, Chris, who adopted dogs through Logan Ryan's efforts and everything. And he teamed with the Nashville Humane Association, and making this whole thing happen. And it was a really good, successful day. And it was a long time dream for Ryan to do something like this, alongside of a team scrimmage or something, there where it was such an incredible amount of people showing up for such a great cause. And there was a lot of other dogs there, Chris, and the ones that were not adopted, the Ryans have issued a statement that they will pay for the adoption fees and everything associated with any future adoptions when those dogs do get adopted. But again, it's a great story. I urge people to go to the Titans website. It's under their community page. Again, it's called the Ryan Animal Rescue Foundation, headed by cornerback Logan Ryan and his wife. So spotlight on them tonight.
Yes, absolutely. That's a fantastic story. And, Bob, tonight I'm going to put my spotlight on Arizona Cardinals tight end Jermaine Gresham for the numerous random acts of kindness that he does on a regular basis. And let me give you some examples of the things that he has done. Back on May 30th, Lila Cassidy, who is a law student at Arizona State, was tweeting about an experience she was having at an airport gate en route to getting on a flight en route to Phoenix, back from Phoenix from a trip over to Europe. She was about to board a flight, and at the gate, the attendant told her that she was going to have to pay $50 to bring a carry-on luggage, you know, on board the plane. And if she didn't want to pay the $50, she'd have to go back to the counter and then give, you know, her luggage there and make her way back to the flight. And if she did that, she was going to miss the flight, and she didn't have the money. A stranger standing behind her said he'd pay for her, you know, $50 for her luggage, and that stranger was Jermaine Gresham. On another occasion, he walked into a nail salon in Scottsdale, Arizona, paid for everybody's manicures that was there. At a supermarket in Tempe, Arizona, a woman was attempting to, you know, she needed to buy milk and bread and diapers, and when she opened her wallet, she had to kind of, you know, search around for loose change because she realized she didn't have enough money sitting in her wallet. So she started to kind of go through her loose change to see if she was going to have enough money. She didn't have the money, but a guy standing in line, two people behind her, paid for her groceries. And that was Jermaine Gresham. When he played for the Bengals, he pulled up to a downtown Cincinnati hotel where, you know, the other players were telling him, hey, you can go there and park your car for the day and just, you know, tip the valet and you'll be good to go. So he pulls in. The valet happened to recognize him and said he could, you know, park his car there, no problem. And then out of the back of the SUV stepped two men and a woman who appeared to be homeless. He took them out to eat and bought them new clothes. When Delilah, you know, Cassidy, the first story, was tweeting about her experience, people started chiming in with their stories about Jermaine Gresham. A Cardinal fan commented about a time when Gresham and some of the other players were there before a game and they were signing autographs. And the person wrote, you know, most of the players come by, they've got their headphones on, they sign, they don't pay attention really, and they go on about their way. Not Jermaine Gresham. He takes the headphones off, he sits there and chats with them and makes it a more personal experience. Gresham once, you know, when they were down in New Orleans, right, playing a game with against the Saints, he happened to witness that a Saints fan stole a football away from some of the Bengals fans. So he walked over, grabbed some footballs, went over, signed them, and handed them back to the Bengals fans. He once gave a homeless man $100 because that homeless man put 50 cents into a parking meter that prevented Gresham from getting a $55 parking ticket. He gave the man $100 for his efforts. He has sent autographed jerseys to winners of youth football leagues. He donated $60,000 to his high school alma mater so they could buy new uniforms, gear, and equipment, not only for the football team, but for both the boys and the girls basketball teams as well. So, Bob, you know what? Stock way up on Jermaine Gresham for not only the great things that he is doing, but just for being an overall fantastic human being, Bob.
You know, just, I didn't want you to stop, Chris. I mean, there's got to be more, right? Keep going. You know, that was just so great to hear. I mean, and I'm thinking while you're saying all these things, and these are very small, in the bigger picture, these are very kind of just daily situations where people can help out. And it doesn't have to be an organized event. It doesn't have to be a foundation. You just, these are the things we know that he's done. Can you imagine? He gets it, Chris. It's down to the,
yes,
the average person doing it on just any day of the week, to make somebody's day better. And that's where it all starts. And my goodness, just hearing that, you know, I like to hear more about this guy, and I'll have to look up some more things because, that's just tremendous. I get the feeling that he's going to be doing this for an awful long time.
Yeah, and it, you know, and the stories go on, and you're right. You know, and please do look it up. And it was out there on Twitter. I put it out there on my Twitter page earlier this week, kind of, you know, hinting that we were going to be doing this story, you know, tonight. But he, you know, talks about this is just the way he was raised. It's just the way his mom raised him. So I'm agreeing with you, Bob. I'm sure we're going to hear a lot more very similar stories about Jermaine Gresham. All right, folks, time for us to put a bow on this episode of Thursday Night Tailgate. We want to send out our sincere thanks again to Paul Alexander, Tony Collins, Ricardo McDonald, Al Oliver, and Olandis Gary for joining us. And as always, Bob, biggest thrill is spending my Thursday nights with you, my friend.
That went by very quickly, Chris, and it's also my honor to work with you. And those are some old friends and one new one tonight, and it's always a pleasure to talk and cross over the sports, too. That's fun this time of the year.
Next week, scheduled to join us, our former Colts and Raiders running back, Dominic Rhodes. Looking forward to catching up with Dominic. We'll also get a return visit from former Rams defensive back, Leroy Irvin. Ricardo's twin brother, Devon McDonald, working to get him as part of the show with us as well. And, of course, Tony Collins will join us just like he does every week. Want to remind everybody how you can stay up to date with the things that we're doing on social media. Well, first, check us out on Facebook. Both Bob and I have our own Facebook pages, as well as we've got one for the show, Thursday Night Tailgate. Give us a like. That's very important to us. On Twitter, you can follow me at CT Mascaro. Bob is at Bob_Lazzari. The show is at TNT Podcast. Bob, take us home, my friend.
Okay, Chris, we'll do it again next week. And we want to send shout-outs and thanks to our announcer, Joe Lajanusa, for the great job he always does with our intro and ads. We want to also thank Kyle Turley and the Kyle Turley Band for the upcoming outro music you'll hear. And on behalf of myself and Chris, we want to thank you out there, everyone, for listening tonight. We appreciate you the very most. And until next week, good night, Kevin, and good night, Terry. We miss you guys.
Coming down the mountain, I take a breath of sand. Can't tell the day or time, but I know this day will end. On a mission I can't